It is now time for question period. The member from Elgin, Middlesex, London.
Thank you, Speaker. Speaker, my question is to the Premier. Premier, the Greater Sudbury Police Services commit their members to four key values. Those four values are respect, integrity, commitment, and honesty. Do you believe the members of the Police Services Board, especially the Chair, are above the same values of their police servicemen and women? Do you believe the board members, like your friend Jerry Loghig, are above the law?
Thank you, Premier.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. You know, it's very hard on one hand to say that we have a deep respect for the Police Services Board and then on the other hand question that the capacity of the Police Services Board to make decisions, Mr. Speaker. I think the member opposite knows full well that the Police Services Board act independently, Mr. Speaker. They have responsibility for police services in their municipalities. And, Mr. Speaker, I have a lot of confidence in their ability in Sudbury to do their job, Mr. Speaker.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Thank you, Speaker. Speaker, back to the Premier. Premier, it's obvious that members of the Liberal Party do not hold themselves to the same standards. The Sudbury Police commit to integrity by pledging we perform our duties with high ethical and moral standards. The service says our actions demonstrate our respect for the community. Jerry Loghig has been recorded offering an apparent bribe on behalf of your party. Premier, how is he demonstrating integrity or respect for Sudbury?
Again, Mr. Speaker, I say to the member opposite, the police services boards in this province have a very serious responsibility for the provision of adequate and effective services in their municipalities, Mr. Speaker, and I have a lot of faith in their ability to do that, including, Mr. Speaker, in this instance. Mr. Speaker, the member opposite knows that there is an investigation going on. He also knows that that investigation is going on outside of this legislature, and we're going to let that unfold with the authorities, and we will continue to cooperate with them, Mr. Speaker.
The member from Renfrew, Nipissing, Pembroke will come to order. And I will keep track.
Final. Speaker, back to the Premier again. Premier, let me tell you what the police service says about honesty. They say they are truthful, open, and fair. About commitment, they say we are dedicated to serving the needs of our community. The nomination certainly was not truthful, open, or fair. It is clear Jerry Loghig does not live up to the values of the board. Premier, do you believe Jerry Loghig's actions were honest and in line with the values of the board?
Minister of Community Safety Protection Services.
Minister of Community and Safety.
Thank you very much, Speaker. And I again remind the member opposite that there's a process in place when it comes to dealing with matters like this. There's a code of conduct in place that is enacted through the regulation. It is really up to the local police services board to determine whether they suspect if there's a breach of code of conduct. And if so, they can refer the matter to the Ontario Civilian Police Commission. In fact, Speaker, I'm sure the member opposite knows that's exactly the process that is being followed now. The Sudbury Police Services has been in touch with the Ontario Civilian Police Commission, and I'm sure OCPC is looking into the matter. That is the proper course. That is the process that's laid out. It's arm's length from the government, Speaker. We should respect that process. Thank you very much.
New question, the member from Dufferin-Caledon.
Thank you, Speaker. My question is to the Premier. Whether we're asking these questions outside or inside the legislature, you have a responsibility to answer them. These tapes don't lie. You obviously had not yet made the decision to appoint Mr. Thibault on December 11th when you spoke to Mr. Olivier. Mr. Olivier said that, quote, he told you he wanted 24 hours to think about it. If you had told him you were appointing Mr. Thibault, there'd be nothing to think about. There would be no nomination. Yet Pat Sobera called 24 hours later, on December 12th, to tell Olivier that if he was to continue, he would put the Premier in a tough position to make a decision about an appointment or to continue on with the nomination. So again, the question, when exactly did you tell Mr. Olivier you were appointing another candidate?
Well, Mr. Speaker, let me say again, and the member opposite may not want to accept that there's an investigation going on outside of the House, but there is. I have said clearly in direct answer to this question that I had decided after my meeting with Glenn Thibault at the end of November that Glenn Thibault was the best person for our role as a candidate in Sudbury, Mr. Speaker. I had made that decision. So, Mr. Speaker, I made that statement 2 Fridays ago. I've been very upfront about that, Mr. Speaker. But there is an investigation going on, and it's going on outside of this House, Mr. Speaker.
Thank you, supplementary.
And we continue to demand answers inside this House. In the interests of government transparency, let's try this again. Mr. Olivier has told the police that on December 11th, you asked him to step aside. You tell us in this chamber that on December 11th, you told Andrew Olivier you were appointing a candidate. What you say in this chamber is not subject to perjury laws, but what Mr. Olivier says to the police absolutely is. So which version of this conversation is correct?
Mr. Speaker, I have worked very hard to make it clear that I take this matter very seriously. I made a statement 2 Fridays ago, Mr. Speaker. I talked about the decision that I made about who the candidate was going to be in Sudbury, Mr. Speaker. I was very clear about that, and I have said—
I'm going to ask the member from Lanark to withdraw. Oh, I believe I heard it. Carry on.
I have said, Mr. Speaker, that we will work with the authorities, but, Mr. Speaker, that work is not going to go on inside this legislature. The investigation is happening outside the legislature, and we need to let it unfold there, Mr.
Answer,
Speaker.
Thank you. Final supplementary.
Premier, what is clear is what Jerry Lougheed said. It's on tape. What is clear is what Mr. Olivier said. It's
Deputy
on
House
tape.
Leader, second
what
time.
Is clear is what Pat Sobera said. It's on tape. What is not clear is what you did, what you offered, what you guaranteed. What you say in this chamber is not subject to perjury laws. Mr.
Order. Please finish.
The only thing that is not clear is what you said, what you offered, what you directed your staff to do. Is the real reason there are two different versions of this account conversation because in here you're protected from perjury? Out there, Mr. Olivier isn't?
Seated, please. Premier.
Minister of Community Safety Correction Services.
Thank you very much, Speaker. And again, I remind the member, all the members, as they recognize that there is an ongoing investigation. This is not the place or the venue to be engaging in an investigation, Speaker. That is up to the independent
Michael
authorities to look into the matter and make a determination. I think, Speaker, the only proper thing to do is let the authorities undertake the investigation and make the final determination. In fact, Speaker, I will say I agree with the member from Leeds Granville, where he said to a QP briefing that there is an investigation going on. The government should not be interfering, and I quote, he said, "Let it run its course." I agree, Speaker.
Answer.
The member from Leeds Granville is right. Let the investigation run its course. Thank you.
New question. The leader of the third party.
Thank you, Speaker. My question is for the Premier. When did the Premier decide to appoint her Sudbury candidate?
Thank you, Premier.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. And I have, I've answered that question many times, and I actually have answered it this morning, Mr. Speaker. I said quite clearly in my public statement that after I had met Glenn Thibault at the end of November, I had decided that he was the best candidate for Sudbury, for the Liberals, Mr. Speaker. And I think that that has been borne out, Mr. Speaker. The people of Sudbury chose Glenn Thibault as their representative at Queen's Park, Mr. Speaker, and we're very pleased to have him. As the leader of the third party knows, there is an investigation going on, but it's going on outside of this House, and we will work with the authorities, Mr. Speaker.
Thank you, supplementary.
Speaker, I assume a letter was sent by the Premier because the Liberal Party Constitution says, quote, the leader shall communicate his or her intention to make such appointment as soon as possible and in writing to the nomination commissioner and to the president of the constituency association, unquote.
Her from Newmarket, Aurora, come to order.
Speaker, on what date did the Premier write her letter to the Nomination Commissioner and the President of the Constituency Association?
Mr. Speaker, again, I say to the member opposite, I have made a clear statement in the public realm, Mr. Speaker. I have said exactly what our position is. I have said that we will continue to work with the authorities. The fact is that the authorities will be asking questions of me, Mr. Speaker. I will work with them. But that investigation and that process is going to happen outside of this legislature, as it should, Mr. Speaker.
Thank you. Final supplemental.
Well, Speaker, it's obvious the Premier has her version of the Liberal bribery scandal. The problem is that her story doesn't match anyone else's, and the Premier's refusing to answer the question, Speaker, to provide any information that would back up her story at all. When will the Premier provide some evidence, Speaker, that backs up her version of the story and makes it clear that Pat Cerbera's version is wrong, Jerry Lougheed's version is wrong, Glenn Thibault's version is wrong, Andrew Olivier's version is wrong, the Sudbury Liberal Riding Association's version is wrong, the OPP's version is wrong, and Election Ontario's version is wrong?
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. Well, as I said, the investigation is happening outside of this House. But, Mr. Speaker, I know that the leader of the third party would like to rewrite a version of what happened in Sudbury, Mr. Speaker, because the leader of the third party would very much like to have won that nomination, would have liked to have won that election, Mr. Speaker, and she didn't. So she'd like to rewrite history. It's not going to happen, Mr. Speaker.
Thank you. New question? New question?
Thank you, Speaker. My question is for the Premier. Premier says, the Deputy Premier actually says that she's bored with question period, and now the Premier doesn't want to answer any questions about the Sudbury bribery scandal. Speaker, this place belongs to Ontarians, and they deserve answers, and it shouldn't take a police investigation to get answers to some very important questions. But the Premier seems to think that she's above the law and above our democracy. Does the Premier think that that sort of Liberal arrogance is acceptable?
Thank you,
Mr. Speaker, if the leader of the third party is suggesting that I don't have the stamina to answer her questions, she's absolutely wrong, Mr. Speaker. I may not be running a marathon these days, Mr. Speaker, but I can answer your questions. I will answer them every single time they are posed to me, Mr. Speaker, as many times as you choose to ask me.
You can do this for the rest of the year.
Supplementary.
Speaker, yesterday the Premier said.
Stop the clock, please. This is my moment to remind all of us that we are racing to the top. The Minister of Natural Resources and Forestry, I could do without the interjection. And that goes for members on both sides, because I'm hearing, while she's putting the question, the same amount of noise. Please continue.
Speaker, yesterday the Premier said there is an investigation outside this House or outside this legislature a full 27 times, and she's said it yet again today a couple of times. Speaker, Ontarians shouldn't need the police to get simple answers to basic questions from the Premier. Especially when the Premier keeps insisting that there was no wrongdoing. Will the Premier show some respect to Ontarians and start answering important questions like, who decided to offer Andrew Olivier a job?
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. And I have a deep respect for the people of Ontario, and I have a deep respect for the policy issues that our government is grappling with, Mr. Speaker. And I have absolutely every desire to answer questions about government policy, any questions that are posed to me. And, Mr. Speaker, I will answer any questions that are asked of me. I have done that. I will continue to do that. And the answer to the question that the leader of the third party has posed is that there is an investigation happening outside of this House, Mr. Speaker. I will continue to work with the authorities, as I expect everyone would, Mr. Speaker.
The Sudbury bribery scandal and the way that this Premier is handling it raises some really basic questions about this government, about her government, Speaker. It raises questions about whether people can believe her government. It raises questions about how a government can end up with four concurrent police investigations into its actions. It raises basic questions, Speaker, about trust, about whose interests the Liberals are putting first in the work that they do. Now, can the Premier answer a simple question and tell Ontarians who gave Pat Cervera and Jerry Lougheed their orders to offer a job to Andrew Olivier so that he would not run for the nomination in the Sudbury by-election?
Just because members shift where they're sitting during the day, I have the floor. Doesn't mean that it gives you the right to heckle any more or any less. It just, you're not supposed to. Premier, please.
You know, I have said, and I will say again, that I take this matter very seriously, but when the premise of the question is something that I absolutely disagree with, Mr. Speaker, it's important for me to be clear with the people of Ontario where we're at. There's an investigation going on. Elections Ontario, the chief electoral officer has said clearly, and I quote, "I am neither deciding to prosecute a matter nor determining anyone's guilt or innocence. Those decisions are respectively for prosecutors and judges," unquote. So it's up to the prosecutors and the judges, Mr. Speaker. It's up to that process to unfold as it should, as the chief electoral officer has said, Mr. Speaker. And so that's why I continue to say that the investigation is happening outside of this House. It is not up to the leader of the third party, Mr. Speaker, to pass judgment. It is up to the authorities to undertake that investigation outside of this legislature.
The member from Leeds Gringle.
Thanks very much, Speaker. My question is to the Premier. Premier, yesterday I asked you some very simple and straightforward questions. Yet, after you left the House and you were admonished by a member of the
media, member from Eglinton,
a member of your staff actually said, answered the truth. Premier, I'm going to ask you again. Yes or no? Have you or your lawyers been asked by the OPP for a meeting to discuss the Sudbury bribery scandal?
Mr. Speaker, I have said publicly that I was going to be meeting with the OPP. I've been asked for that meeting, but I don't know, Mr. Speaker, that it's been set up. I don't know the date. So I've said that clearly, and as I said, I will continue to cooperate with the authorities in every way.
Premier, again, back to the Premier. Again, this is what we face with this government. You know, we had a debate yesterday on concurrence of supply. There's so many questions this government refuses to answer. When it comes to the gas plant committee, they shut it down, even knowing that emails have been deleted and hard drives have been wiped clean. We in the opposition on both sides have asked repeatedly, over and over and over again, who knew what? Who directed who to make these offers? Premier, are you
Minister
going to come clean with the OPP? Are you finally going to answer those questions that members of the opposition have asked? Who authorized these offers to be made to Andrew Olivier from your party?
Thank you, Premier.
Let me just say again that I made a decision that Glenn Thibault was the right person to be our candidate in Sudbury, Mr. Speaker. I made that decision at the end of November, and Mr. Speaker, I've made a public statement about that, and I will continue to work with the authorities on the investigation that's happening outside of this House, Mr. Speaker.
Thank you. Your question, the member for King's James Bay.
My question is to the Premier. The Premier is aware that she has the authority to appoint or revoke any appointment to a board or commission with the stroke of a pen. Given the appointments are done at the Premier's discretion, when will you file the paperwork to remove Jerry Lougheed from the Police Services Boards of Sudbury?
Premier.
Minister of Community Safety, Correctional Services.
Minister of Community Safety.
Thank you very much, Speaker. And I will repeat what I've said at numerous occasions in this House, and the member opposite, I am sure, knows about this process as well.
The
Police Services Board are responsible for local policing. They have both municipal and provincial appointees. The members of the boards are the ones who elect a chair. And they're all within the scope of a code of conduct, Speaker.
The member from Lanark,
come to order.
And it's up to
them to determine if they suspect a breach of the code of conduct. Then we have an independent body, the Ontario Civilian Police Commission, to make a determination whether a breach of code of conduct has taken place. It is not up to the government, Speaker, to make that determination. My understanding is, and I'm sure the member opposite knows, that the Sudbury Police Services Board has reached out to OCPC.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Well, The Premier would also, and again to the Premier, the Premier would know that she has the authority under Legislative Act 2006, Section 76, that says they serve at your pleasure. Premier, I think we both agree that those appointed to public boards and commissions should meet a standard of integrity. Clearly, Jerry Lougheed's integrity is in question. Premier, by not using your power to remove Mr. Lougheed from the Police Services Board, are you saying integrity does not matter to public appointees?
Minister.
Thank you very much, Speaker. Speaker, the work of Police Services Board is extremely important.
The
Police Services Board, Speaker, are created pursuant to the Police Services Act. They've been given some very specific responsibility under the Police Services Act to ensure that there is adequate and effective policing within their jurisdiction. That's why, Speaker, their work is so important that we have a separate code of conduct that is enacted through regulation to ensure that their proper conduct is met. On top of that, Speaker, to ensure that the code of conduct is always abided by, we have a separate independent body called the Ontario Civilian Police Commission to oversee Police Services Board. So you can see, Speaker, that we have taken several steps to make sure that the process is always arm's length from the government, that the local communities are in charge when it comes to local policing. And as we know in this particular case, Police Services Board has referred the matter.
Thank you. New question, the member from Etobicoke Lakeshore.
Mr. Speaker, my question is to the Minister of Government and Consumer Services. It's about government policy, Mr. Speaker. I understand that your ministry is responsible for providing oversight to Tarion, an administrative authority that manages the Ontario New Home Warranties Act to ensure new homeowners are protected. Mr. Speaker, every year in Etobicoke Lakeshore, hundreds of new homes and condos are built and people move into them. And they often ask me for some advice about how Tarion functions, because purchasing a new home is very significant. And it's one of those things that most Ontarians might only do once or twice in their lifetime. It's important to ensure that these homes are properly built. And I know that problems with a new home can be a major source of stress for some homeowners. And your ministry has information available which can help them handle these problems without further anxiety. Through you, Mr.
Question.
Speaker, Minister, can you share with us your recommendations for Ontarians who have a concern with the new home they've purchased?
Thank you, Minister of Government and Consumer Services.
Thank you, Speaker. And I want to thank the hardworking member from Etobicoke Lakeshore for this important question. It's certainly part of our ministry's mandate to ensure that consumers are well informed and protected under the Ontario New Home Warranties Plan Act. We're periodically asked by Ontarians questions about Tarion, and I'm always interested to hear the feedback. The first step for a new home purchaser is to become well informed. Like any warranty program, consumers should be aware of the terms of the agreement and make sure to report any concerns within the time frame of the warranty coverage period. Consumers are protected 1 year for any unauthorized changes. They're protected for up to 2 years on electrical, plumbing, heating, or water issues, and up to 7 years on major structural defects like the failure of a load-bearing wall. I encourage consumers to first seek a solution with their builders, but they should not hesitate to follow up with Tarion if issues are not properly addressed. My expectation is Tarion will continue to help Ontarians, and I look forward to continuing to work with them.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, and I want to thank the minister for all of his hard work for consumers and especially for new homeowners. Many people in Etobicoke Lakeshore are really interested to hear about the progress Tarion is making to support Ontarians when they purchase new homes. Mr. Speaker, I know the minister has worked closely with Tarion to strengthen accountability and ensure consumer interests are protected. I'm very proud of our government for its ongoing focus on transparency and accountability, and know the Minister of Government and Consumer Services has approached his responsibilities with that in mind. While Tarion is an independent, not-for-profit organization, I understand the minister is working with its leadership to improve its consumer protection. Mr. Speaker, can the minister please explain what steps are being taken to improve consumer
Question.
Protection?
Tarion. Thank you, Minister.
Thank you, Speaker, and again to the member from Etobicoke Lakeshore. Certainly happy to outline ways in which we've worked with Terrien to improve consumer protection. I'd like to start by referencing the Terrien Builder Registry, which was relaunched in December of 2013. It tracks important information on builders across Ontario, where they've built homes, if their licenses have been revoked or suspended, how many claims have been filed against them. Within the next year, Terrien will be adding additional information to the registry. Terrien's also doubled the warranty coverage from $150,000 to $300,000. They've made changes to the board, removing the majority of industry members so that there's truly a balance on the board. And, Speaker, these improvements are working. Data indicates that last year, in over 365,000 homes under warranty, only 0.27% have had a site visit from Terrien. We're continuing to work to strengthen the DAA legislation. I look forward to making these improvements. Speaker, while the opposition talks about consumer protection, we're acting on it.
Thank you. New question, the member from Nicholson.
My question is for the Premier. Good morning, Premier. Your pattern of behaviour with your Sudbury scandal is hauntingly familiar to that of the gas plant scandal. Both have several people named in the OPP warrants continuing to hold plum, well-paying government jobs or government appointments. Pat Sorbera is still in the Premier's office, but so is Becky Codd-Downey, who admitted to deleting gas plant emails. Leon Corby's still advising you, yet Laura Miller added his hard drive to the list to be deleted. We're still waiting for you to ask BC Premier Christy Clark to tell Laura Miller to come back and answer the OPP's questions. Premier, do you plan on holding any of these people to account?
Well, Mr. Speaker, again, let me just say to the member opposite that he knows full well that there's an investigation going on outside of the House. He may have made decisions about what people did or what they didn't do, Mr. Speaker, but in fact, there are authorities who are looking into this, Mr. Speaker, and we will continue to work with those authorities, and that will happen outside of the legislature.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Thank you. Well, it's hard to, Speaker, to the Premier, it's hard to avoid those tapes and the deleted files which have been recovered. I know it's hard for you to acknowledge those, but Premier, there's mounting evidence that people of Ontario aren't satisfied with your handling of the Sudbury by-election scandal. As many as two-thirds of Ontarians believe Pat Sorbera and Jerry Lougheed should step down while the OPP investigate bribery allegations. Premier, your blatant Liberal self-interest is putting you out of step with the democratic values we hold in this province and indeed in this country. When will you stop protecting your Liberal insiders and start protecting the integrity of the office you hold?
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. Well, if we want to talk about a democratic process, the by-election was a democratic process.
Absolutely.
And the people of Sudbury made a decision, Mr. Speaker. They made a decision in full knowledge of the situation, Mr. Speaker, and they chose the Liberal candidate, Glenn Thibault, to be their representative at Queen's Park, Mr. Speaker. I have full faith in the people of Sudbury and their ability to make a sound decision, Mr.
Absolutely.
Speaker, and we're very pleased to have the new member for Sudbury sitting with our government, Mr. Speaker.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. My question is to the Premier. Mr. Speaker, when was the Premier contacted by the OPP to indicate that they wanted to investigate her or they wanted to speak to her about the bribery scandal?
Mr. Speaker, as I've said, we'll be working with the authorities. I've said clearly that I will be having a conversation with the OPP, Mr. Speaker. I actually don't know the date of that. I know that that is being arranged, and as I've said quite clearly, I will continue to cooperate with the authorities on the investigation outside of the legislature.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Thank you very much. I have two questions. I'm going to ask the first question again. When did the OPP contact the Premier to say that they wanted to meet with the Premier regarding the bribery scandal? They wanted to interview her about that scandal, one. And two, the second question is, when that meeting is set, will the Premier keep that meeting secret, or will the Premier tell Ontarians when that meeting will take place?
Thank you, Premier.
Mr. Speaker, that meeting is being set up. I don't know the date of it. The investigation is happening outside of this legislature, Mr. Speaker. I will work with the authorities, Mr. Speaker, and that is as it should be. We cannot we cannot undertake the investigation here in the legislature, Mr. Speaker. Much as the third party would like to do that, much as the opposition would like to do that, Mr. Speaker, it has to happen outside of the legislature, and that's as it should be, Mr. Speaker.
Two new questions, the member from Burlington.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. My question is to the Minister of Economic Development, Employment and Infrastructure, and concerns things that Ontarians care about, Speaker, job creation and investment.
Yes.
Just last week, Ford Canada announced an additional 400 jobs to their Oakville facility.
That's great.
This is where the global production of the new Ford Edge crossover SUV is set to launch. This facility will be one of the most sophisticated assembly plants in the world. This is great news for Oakville, for Burlington, Halton Region, and indeed our province. As a matter of fact, many of the employees who work at the plant live in my riding, Mr. Speaker. And this announcement builds on one made just a year and a half ago when our government, in partnership with Ford Canada and the federal government, announced a $700 million investment to upgrade the Oakville Assembly Plant. This partnership has secured more than 2,800 jobs. Mr. Speaker, my understanding is that this is not the only good news in the auto sector this week. Would the minister please update the House on some of the exciting investments and partnerships taking place in our province between our government and the auto sector?
Thank you,
Mr. Speaker.
Mr. Speaker, it is great to get another question on government policy. The second today, it's good to see the member standing up for a very important announcement made by Ford in Oakville, an announcement that certainly impacts her constituents, impacts constituents in Oakville, and constituents throughout the Greater Toronto Hamilton area. And I say that, Mr. Speaker, and it's not the only good news announcement that we've had this week. Our government also announced through the Southwestern Ontario Development Fund that we're partnering with Toyota Boshoku Canada by investing $1 million to expand its Elmira manufacturing facility. Through this investment, Mr. Speaker, we'll be able to create and sustain 460 highly skilled jobs. This strategic investment further enhances Ontario's industry supply chain. Mr. Speaker, I know why the side opposite gets upset when we see all these great investments in auto, because if they were in power, Mr. Speaker, our auto industry would have left on.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Mr. Speaker, I'd like to thank the minister for that update. This is great news, not only for the sector, but for the related advanced manufacturing facilities located in Burlington that will benefit from these investments. I know that experts agree, whether it's CIBC, Toronto Dominion Bank, the RBC, Bank of Montreal, or the Conference Board of Canada, Ontario is projected for economic growth in 2015 and is poised to lead the country.
Yeah, that's great.
Indeed, the Conference Board of Canada is forecasting that Ontario's economic growth will be at 2.9% this year, well above the national average of 1.9%. Comparing this with last week's auto announcements, clearly our economic plan is working for Ontarians. Could the minister please share with the House further evidence of these kinds of investments and clearly the corresponding confidence in our economy that they represent? Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
Thank you, Minister.
Absolutely, Mr. Speaker. And I'll pick up where I left off. And, you know, we remember the party opposite, the PC, said, let those plants close. Mr. Speaker, we did not let those plants close. In fact, we've seen $4 billion in investment in those plants, Mr. Speaker, since November. We've seen investments in Alliston and Honda, $857 million. Linamar and Guelph, almost $500 million. Chrysler and Windsor, $2 billion. Ford, they announced the GT Ford was going to be made in Markham, Ontario, the coolest car being built in North America today. GM, $500 million, Mr. Speaker, just made that announcement a few weeks ago. And then we had the announcement by Ford of 400 jobs. Our auto sector is growing again, Mr. Speaker. It's growing because of the investments and partnerships we made in spite of their policy, which would have been to abandon the sector. We're proud of that, Mr. Speaker. Very proud of that.
Be seated, please. Be seated, please. New question, the member from York Simcoe.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, my question is to the Premier about your bribery scandal in Sudbury. Frankly, my constituents and I are appalled by your involvement, your Deputy Chief of Staff's involvement, and your top fundraiser involvement in offering an inducement to last year's Liberal candidate so he did not run in the recent by-election. This is a new kind of scandal that sheds light on one of your backroom deals. When the chief electoral officer forwarded his investigation of this matter to the OPP, he said The charges, he suggests, are unprecedented. Unprecedented means he has never seen such a breach of ethics under the Ontario Elections Act. Premier, are you aware of any other time that our chief electoral officer forwarded his concerns to the OPP?
So, Mr. Speaker, I hope when the member opposite's constituents are in touch with her that she goes on to tell them that Elections Ontario determined that the allegations against me and against the member for Sudbury were baseless. She goes on then to tell them, Mr. Speaker, that I have said repeatedly that we'll continue to cooperate fully with the authorities. And then I hope she quotes from the chief electoral officer who said, and I quote, Mr. Speaker, I am neither deciding to prosecute a matter nor determining anyone's guilt or innocence. Those decisions are respectively for prosecutors and judges, unquote, Mr. Speaker. I hope that she gives her constituents the full story, Mr.
I'm
Speaker,
sure
when
does.
They contact her. I'm sure she does. I'm sure she does.
Premier, this is a serious situation. This is not like any other accusations. The chief electoral officer says it's unprecedented.
Here, here.
The OPP will most likely take his interpretation of the law when considering charges. Premier, why are you acting as if this is routine, like it's a normal process for every election?
Sadly, it is for them.
We all know this is an unprecedented situation. Premier, you have not seen fit to ask either Sabara or Lougheed to step down. To demonstrate your recognition of the seriousness of these unprecedented charges, what action are you prepared to take?
Well, Mr. Speaker.
Proceed, please. Thank you. Premier.
Here again, I
delete your comments. Carry on, please.
Well, again, Mr. Speaker, I'm sure that the member opposite, when her constituents contact her, I'm sure she lets them know that I have said repeatedly that I'm taking this matter very seriously, that I am working with the authorities, Mr. Speaker, and that I will continue to do so, Mr. Speaker. It's an investigation that is taking place. It's an investigation that's taking place outside of this legislature, and I will continue to work with the authorities.
Qualified people.
Thank you. Your question, the member from Hamilton East County Creek.
Thank you, Speaker. My question is to the Premier. Speaker, this morning, the Toronto 2015 unveiled the competition medals for Pan Am and Parapan Games.
You see it, please. You see it, please. Order. Order.
Are you ready for it, Michael?
I would like to do without the interjections. Member, put his question, please.
Speaker, good news. The first gold medal will be going to the Liberal government for outstanding achievement in synchronized scandals. On just one, the subversion of the electoral process in Sudbury. On what date and what time did the Premier communicate in writing her intention to appoint Glenn Thibault as candidate for the Sudbury by-election?
Minister responsible for the Pan Parapan Games.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. This morning I had the opportunity to join the minister, the finance minister for Canada, the mayor of Toronto, Chief Laforme from the Mississauga of the New Credit, and many others. In fact, there was about 500 people
the
at the Royal Museum as we celebrated the unveiling of the
second
new medals. That the gold medal is actually from Ontario. It's mine from Ontario here. And it's a in partnership with the Royal Canadian Mint and Mady Designer and many other people. And Mr. Speaker, I think we should be so proud of the fact that we have the largest international sporting event in the history of this country taking place in 18 Tuesdays from today. So I'm very, very proud that it's coming, and we're very proud of our record as a government when it comes to the Pan Am Games.
Seated, please. Thank you. Supplementary.
Thank you, Speaker. Basically, back to the Premier. Speaker, this is a very simple, direct question, and the Premier is not answering. Premier, I'm afraid I'm going to have to award you another gold medal for verbal gymnastics. It's a shame you won't let me hand out any medals for accountability. The question was, on what date and what time did the Premier, in fact, appoint Glenn Thibault as candidate for the Sudbury by-election?
Minister.
You know, Mr. Speaker, the medals that were unveiled today for the first time in any International Olympic Associated Games were unveiled with Braille on them, and I thought it was incredible. And I know Minister Duguid is looking at the accessibility piece when it comes to Ontario, and these games are going to be the most accessible games in the history of any games out there. And I'm very proud of our record. And you know, the minister from Hamilton, the member from Hamilton, can joke and say, you know, and associate the Pan Am Games and make light of it, but we take these games very serious. The accessibility piece is a serious part, and we're very proud of our record here in Ontario.
New question, the member from Kingston and the Islands.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. My question is for the minister responsible for women's issues. Minister, on Friday of last week, the Premier led an Ontario delegation which included you, the Minister of Aboriginal Affairs, and the Minister of Community Safety and Correctional Services to the roundtable on missing and murdered Indigenous women and girls in Ottawa. A national inquiry would provide a renewed focus on the underlying root causes, it would shed light on the severity of the issue, and it would help point to potential solutions. That is why I was so proud when this House passed my motion unanimously to support the call by the national Aboriginal organizations for a national inquiry on murdered and missing Aboriginal women and girls. The disproportionate violence against Aboriginal women and girls is a national tragedy. We must work with our Aboriginal brothers and sisters. Minister, will you please update the House on last week's roundtable?
Thank you. Minister of Children and Youth Services.
Thank you, Speaker. And I really want to thank the member for Kingston and the Islands for her question and her activism on this issue, not just today, but since she became a member of this legislature. So I thank her for that. The roundtable was a step in the right direction, Speaker, and we are pleased the federal government did agree to work together on a pan-Canadian awareness campaign. However, Speaker, there could have been a lot more action we could have agreed upon on. Based on the discussions at the roundtable, we identified, it was actually 10 specific things from the Ontario delegation we felt were important, action we can take right now to improve the situation facing Aboriginal women and girls. We are proposing a social economic plan for Aboriginal women and girls, supported by leaders of Canada's provinces, territories, national Aboriginal organizations to address root cause of violence. We need to push ourselves very hard, Speaker, in the coming months,
Thank
as
you.
The Premier said, to hold everyone accountable. Yeah. Thank you.
Supplementary.
Thank you to the Minister for that response. I'm glad that the Ontario government presented realistic measures to end the ongoing issue of missing and murdered Aboriginal women and girls. We have to collaborate with our Aboriginal sisters and brothers to develop long-term community-building initiatives, poverty reduction, employment opportunities, safety and policing, and public education, to name a few. For the last 6 months, I've worked with the Native Women's Association of Canada's Faceless Dolls Project in my community of Kingston and the Islands to highlight the plight of the nearly 1,200 missing and murdered Aboriginal women and girls in Canada. My visits with the Aboriginal community elders to school classrooms and religious organizations were emotional experiences. In the absence of strong federal leadership, we must continue to lead the way in raising awareness of this grave issue. Mr. Speaker, through you to the minister, what were some of the outcomes from the National Roundtable this past Friday?
Thank you, Minister.
Mr. Aboriginal Affairs.
Mr. Aboriginal Affairs.
Speaker, the roundtable was a tremendous opportunity to hear from Aboriginal organizations and the families of the missing and murdered Indigenous women. With the presence of three ministers, myself, Minister McCharles, Minister Nakvi, led by our Premier, Ontario had a very, very strong voice at that roundtable. Mm-hmm. As the minister from Kingston, as the member from Kingston highlighted, we need awareness. That is the one consensus that all of the attendees at the roundtable agreed upon, a pan-Canadian prevention and awareness campaign. This will build on existing initiatives and focus on changing the perception and attitudes on this issue of missing Indigenous women and girls. But despite the comments by the Federal Minister Leach, this is not just a local issue of a local individual crime. It's a broader issue. It has to be dealt with in a broader concept.
Answer.
And the federal government can do much, much more on this issue. Thank you, Speaker.
Your question, the member from Perth, Wellington.
Thank you, Speaker. My question is for the Premier. Can the Premier tell us that of a time in the history of the province where the government, including the Premier's own senior staff, has been under four separate OPP investigations?
Hey, another record.
Premier.
I see you, Premier.
Mr. Speaker, again, let me just say to the member opposite what I have said repeatedly. Mr. Speaker, I've been clear about my position. I made a public statement, Mr. Speaker, and I will work with the authorities. But the investigation is taking place outside of this House by the authorities, Mr. Speaker. It is not taking place in here in the legislature, and I will continue to work with them.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Speaker, this is clearly is a clear lack of integrity and accountability. Political points should never trump what's doing what's right. Clearly, the government, with its four ongoing OPP investigations, believes differently. Premier, will you take the first step to rebuilding trust and demand that those who created this mess step down from their public duties?
Well, again, Mr. Speaker, I've been clear. I've been clear about exactly what my position is. I've made that statement publicly, and I know the member opposite can access that. It's in the public realm. I made the statement to
stop the clock, please. The deputy House Leader is warned. Please finish, Premier.
Just to say, Mr. Speaker, that I take it very seriously, and I will work with the authorities outside of this House where the investigation is taking place.
Thank you. New question. The member from Essex.
Thank you, Speaker. My question is to the Premier. Speaker, did the Premier abide by her own party's constitution and send a letter to the Constituency Association and the nomination president as soon as she made her decision, as soon as she made her decision to appoint Glenn Thibault?
I've been given serious consideration and listening very carefully to all of the questions, and in most cases, members have been able to pull everything back to government policy. That's getting dangerously close to having no contact. I'm going to advise the member to make his question adhere to pulling it into government policy. Carry on. Premier.
Thank you very much, Mr. Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. And as I have said repeatedly this morning, there are questions that will be asked as part of an investigation. That investigation is taking place outside of this House, Mr. Speaker, and it is being undertaken by authorities. And I will work with the authorities outside of this House, Mr. Speaker.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Thank you, Speaker. Yes, Premier, we too are anxious for the criminal trial to start. However, it doesn't preclude you from actually answering some very basic questions. Speaker, if the Premier sent a letter that would back up her version of the story, why is she refusing?
Stop the clock, please. Order, please. Order, please. Order, please. And I know I'm on the right track when I get accused by one side of not asking these people to be quiet, and then on this side asking these people to be quiet when they themselves make noise while they're answering. So I will do my best in this chair, and I don't need the armchairs. Please finish.
Speaker, if the Premier sent a letter that would back up her version of the story, why is she refusing to release it? Is it because it actually doesn't exist?
Deputy Premier. Speaker, there are many, many differences between the NDP and the Ontario Liberal Party. Many, many differences. One of those is that we have a very clear process whereby the leader of the party is entitled to exercise her right to appoint candidates. In stark contrast, the NDP chooses to use other tactics when they have a preferred candidate. They do not have that clarity that we have in the Ontario Liberal Party, which is why we have seen the disgraceful contact in Scarborough-Guildwood, where longtime members of the New Democrat Party have been forced to leave the party, have been forced to leave the party because their wishes have been trampled on by the leader of the NDP. So I do believe that Amarjeet Kaur Shah.
Thank you. Thank you. That's time. New question, the member from Ottawa Orleans.
Thank you, Mr. President. My question is for the Associate Minister of Health and Long-Term Care. Mr. Speaker, I know that the parents and the youth in Ottawa Orleans have been advocating for this bill, and I'm proud that this morning we are joined by a group of passionate Ontario youth who are here to support swift passage of Bill 45, the Making Healthier Choices Act. As a part of this proposed legislation, our government is taking strong action to protect youth from the dangers of tobacco. We know that flavored tobacco products are designed to appeal to youth. And then we know that research that almost half of the 121,600 Ontario youths in grade 9 to 12 who have reported using tobacco products in the last 30 days have turned to flavored tobacco. The facts are here. Speaker, could the minister please remind the House that we are proposing to do to protect our children from flavored tobacco?
Thank you, Associate Minister of Long-Term Care, Health and Long-Term Care.
Thank you, Speaker. I'd like to begin by thanking the member from Ottawa Orleans for this really important question. Speaker, to tell you the truth, I was hoping that this question would come from the member from Nickel Belt, who spent a considerable time earlier this morning talking about how important this bill is to her. But alas, not important enough for question period, but there's still some time, and perhaps she will ask the question. But I do thank the member for her question, and yes, she is right. And earlier this morning, Speaker, as you know, I was pleased to meet with some of these dedicated young advocates. They offered advice and, more importantly, their support to get this bill passed, and I'm delighted to see so many young people who share our commitment to drive down smoking rates. Speaker, as we know, the research shows that flavored tobacco is a gateway for young people to become regular smokers. With flavors like strawberry, watermelon, and bubble gum, there is no question that tobacco companies are targeting young people with this marketing, and this bill is all about making sure that next generation of smokers don't begin to smoke.
Thank you. Thank you,
Mr. Speaker. And again, my question is for the Associate Minister of Health and Long-Term Care. Minister, as you know, e-cigarettes use is an emerging trend in Ontario, including among our youth. We have seen a great deal of concern raised by local and international media and the medical community about the possible health effects of hazards of e-cigarettes use. In a recent national survey, it was found that 20% of youth aged 15 to 19 had tried e-cigarettes. That means 417,000 teenagers in that age group have tried e-cigarettes. It is important that our government safeguard youth from an unregulated device that could have negative effects on their health. Mr. Speaker, could the minister please remind us what action she is taking to protect our youth from the possible health effects of e-cigarettes?
Thank you, Minister.
Thank you, Speaker, and thanks again to the member for that very important question. Indeed, e-cigarettes are new technology, and it's the Wild West, frankly, Speaker, when it comes to where you can vape and who can purchase e-cigarettes. And that is why we have proposed legislation that would, if passed, ban retailers from selling e-cigarettes to youth and restrict vaping in public places. In this way, we are proposing to protect young Ontarians from any harm that may be associated with electronic cigarettes. Speaker, the young people today sent us a message very clearly that they want us to help protect them and to make sure that the next generation of vapers doesn't get started.
Thank you, Speaker. Member from Bruce Gray, Owen South.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. My question is to the Premier. Premier, you continue to put partisanship over partnership, ideology over evidence. The evidence from independent officers indicates that there has been a contravention of the law. The members of the opposition side of this House have written to the OPP and to the Chief Electoral Officer supporting their investigations. Premier, when will you demonstrate the integrity expected of your office?
Premier.
Community Safety and Correctional Services.
Minister of Community Safety and Correctional Services.
Well, Speaker, I think that the Premier is exactly showing the respect and integrity that the independent process should have by not interfering in that process. And the members opposite continue to insist that somehow the Premier should intervene in the process and come up with some sort of an outcome that they would prefer. Well, Speaker, I think we all know that's not how the system works. It's arm's length. It's separate from the government. Those systems have been put in place for a reason. We should respect that. Like I said again, I agree with the member from Leeds Granville when he said on Friday to QP briefing that there's a process that's going on. The government should not interfere in that process. And he said, I quote, let it run its course. He's absolutely right, Speaker. We should let the process continue as it is designed to be and respect the outcome. This
Oxford
is not the place to try a case or undertake an investigation, because that's a responsibility of the police and our judges, and we respect them 100%, Speaker. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Again, back to the Premier. This is a bit like Groundhog Day. You are allowed to give answers in this House to the question.
Here, here.
Premier, you have said, and I quote, anything that was offered in exchange for any action is false. End of quote. Anything may be defined by you as a written contract, but the law says otherwise. No matter what the title, no matter what their authority, your staff did your bidding by offering a position to Andrew Olivier. Premier, how much longer will you defy the integrity of this office, your office?
Sir, with all due respect, the role of the government is to make sure that we respect the law and we let the independent authorities do its work. And by asking to interfere in the matter, you're advising the government to do the contrary. I would advise to you that we follow the process, we let the police do its work, we let the Elections Ontario do its work, we let the prosecutor do its work, because that's how the process is done, that's how process works well. And let's focus on issues that are important to Ontarians, like building public infrastructure, like making sure that we're guaranteeing retirement income security for Ontarians. That is the mandate that they have given to this legislature. That is the mandate they've given to this government. We're going to remain focused on those important issues and make sure that the retirement security and the good infrastructure that is so necessary for this province is there for generations to come.
Thank you. No question. The member from Timmins, James Bay.
My question is to the Premier. Premier, you keep on insisting that you decided, in order to appoint Mr. Olivier, in order to appoint Mr. Thibault in November of last year. Clearly, your constitution says that you have to send a letter in order to be able to do that officially through the Liberal Party mechanism. The question we're asking you is, when did you send that letter to both the Liberal Party and to the Riding Association president informing of the decision that you're going to appoint your candidate?
Mr. Community Safety Correctional Services.
Minister of Community Safety and Correctional Services.
Thank you very much, Speaker. And I remind the member opposite again, as he is well aware, that there is an independent process that is ongoing, and it's up to that process to determine the answers to all these questions and make a judgment. We know Elections Ontario has clearly said that they are the election Ontario officer is not making any judgment. He
he's leaving it up to the prosecutors to decide. So the matter has been referred to Public Service, Public Prosecutor Service of Canada. They will undertake their due diligence as required by law for them and make a determination, and then we will respect that. I don't think this is the place, Speaker, to get into all that their work, which is very much within their purview. I urge all the members, Speaker, to let's refocus on issues that are important, issues that are our constituents are speaking to us every single day, such as retirement income security. Thank you, Speaker.
My question is again to the Premier. The Premier has repeatedly said that she decided she was going to appoint her candidate back in November. There is a process under the Liberal Constitution that says that she has to send a letter to the Riding Association President and to the Election Commissioner of the Liberal Party. My question to you, Premier, is when did you send that letter to both the Riding Association President and the Liberal Party? When did you sign that letter?
Minister.
Thank you very much, Speaker. You know, Speaker, I think we all see what the third party is doing. They're trying to distract from their sordid record on progressive policies that have been implemented by this government in this process. When it comes to, Speaker, putting forward the most progressive budget ever in the history of this province, under the leadership of our Premier, where was the third party? They forced an unnecessary election. What was the result of that election, Speaker? That there was a Liberal majority government re-elected in this House. They still have not forgiven themselves for making their wrong-headed decision, and they still continued on to vote against one of the most progressive budgets. And that is why, Speaker, they want to talk about everything else. They don't want to talk about affordable housing that we're investing in. They don't want to talk about raising minimum wage and indexing it to cost of living, which this government brought in and they disagreed with, Speaker. They don't want to talk about the support for developmental sector in this province.
Seated, please. New question. The member from Durham.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. My question is to the Minister of Municipal Affairs and Housing. Minister, this past Friday, you and I celebrated the 10th anniversary of Ontario's Green Belt. This milestone provides an opportunity to reflect on the Green Belt, the role the Green Belt plays in protecting Ontario's most valuable agricultural and environmentally sensitive land. 10 years ago, our government sent a powerful message by creating the Green Belt Plan, which designates the Oak Ridges Moraine, the Niagara Escarpment, and much of our cherished countryside as protected from development. Our government told all Ontarians that we must not take Ontario's natural beauty and important farmland for granted. Minister, as we celebrate this important anniversary of the Green Belt, please remind us of why we can be proud of this world-class model of land preservation.
Thank you. Minister of Municipal Affairs.
Well, Speaker, I'm proud to be able to get up and declare why we're proud about the Green Belt.
Absolutely.
Largest Green Belt in the world, by the way. Larger than the size of Prince Edward Island. You know, protecting farmland, protecting wetlands, you know, coordinating growth. You know, it is part of a comprehensive plan our government has set out over the last decade, and I think it's great to be able to say happy anniversary, Greenbelt.
Mr. Speaker, thank you, Minister. I understand that as part of your mandate as Minister of Municipal Affairs and Housing, the Premier has directed you to lead a review of the Greenbelt Plan in coordination with reviews of the Growth Plan, the Oak Ridges Moraine Plan, and the Niagara Escarpment Plan. Minister, these reviews are an exciting opportunity to build on the plan's successes to date and to identify opportunities to improve the plans where needed. You are required to consult with each municipality that has jurisdiction in the Green Belt and to ensure the public is given an opportunity to provide input. Minister, what details can you share about these coordinated reviews?
Thank you. Minister?
Well,
Mr. Speaker, I want to thank the honourable member from Durham for his question and his wonderful supplementary. We announced on Friday the establishment of a panel set up by the Honourable David Crombie, by the way, who will be heading that, an inspired choice, according to the Caledon Beaver. We'll be working with the Ministry of Natural Resources, holding meetings across the province, Mr. Speaker, to review the four plans. It'll be comprehensive, it'll be coordinated, and in the words of David Crombie, will be a historic undertaking of monumental importance.
Yeah, yeah.
Thank you. The member for Nickelbelt on a point of order.
Thank you, Speaker. I just wanted to know that everybody got a little thank you note this morning to thank them for supporting Freeze the Industry, a group of youth who wants to support Bill 45. And there are mints in there, so remember menthol.
Thank you. It's actually not a point of order, but thank you. We have, deferred votes on the motion of concurrence in supplying the following ministries and offices: tourism, culture, sport, infrastructure, transportation, community, social services, energy, finance, health, long-term care, Aboriginal affairs, Francophone affairs, and consumer services. Call in the members. This will be a 5-minute bell.
Would all members please take their seats? Ms. Sandel has moved concurrence in supply of the Ministry of Tourism, Culture and Sport. All those in favour, please rise one at a time and be recognized by the clerk.
Mr. Nackvi.
Mr. Nackvi.
Mr. Bradley.
Mr. Bradley.
Mr. Shirelli.
Mr. Shirelli.
Madame Mayer.
Madame Mayer.
Mr. Souza.
Mr. Souza.
Ms. Wynn.
Ms. Wynn.
Ms. Matthews.
Ms. Matthews.
Mr. Hoskins.
Mr. Hoskins.
Ms. Sandel.
Ms. Sandel.
Mr. Duguid.
Mr. Duguid.
Ms. McCharles.
Ms. McCharles.
Mr. Quinter.
Mr. Quinter.
Mr. Cole.
Mr. Cole.
Mr. Takar.
Mr. Takar.
Mr. Berardinetti.
Mr. Berardinetti.
Mr. Dillon.
Mr. Dillon.
Mr. Quadri.
Mr. Quadri.
Mr. Orzetti.
Mr. Orzetti.
Mr. Gravel.
Mr. Gravel.
Mr. McMeekin.
Mr. McMeekin.
Mr. Murray.
Mr. Murray.
Mr. Chan.
Mr. Chan.
Mr. Moridi.
Mr. Moridi.
Mr. Coteau.
Mr. Coteau.
Mr. Leal.
Mr. Leal.
Mr. Flynn.
Mr. Flynn.
Mr. Zimmer.
Mr. Zimmer.
Mr. Delaney.
Mr. Delaney.
Mr. Balkison.
Mr. Balkison.
Ms. Albanese.
Ms. Albanese.
Mr. Dixon.
Mr. Dixon.
Ms. Manga.
Ms. Manga.
Mr. Crack.
Mr. Crack.
Ms. Wong.
Ms. Wong.
Ms. Hunter.
Mrs. Hunter.
Mr. Sergio.
Mr. Sergio.
Mr. Morrow.
Mr. Morrow.
Ms. Jassy.
Ms. Jassy.
Mr. Del Duca.
Mr. Del Duca.
Ms. Domerla.
Ms. Domerla.
Mr. Fraser.
Mr. Fraser.
Mr. Anderson.
Mr. Anderson.
Mr. Baker.
Mr. Baker.
Mr. Ballard.
Mr. Ballard.
Mr. Don.
Mr. Dong.
Ms. Hogarth.
Ms. Hogarth.
Ms. Koala.
Ms. Koala.
Madame Lalonde.
Madame Lalonde.
Ms. Molly.
Ms. Molly.
Mrs. Martin.
Mrs. Martin.
Mrs. McMahon. Mrs. McGarry.
Mrs. McGarry.
Ms. McMahon.
Ms. McMahon.
Mr. Milchin.
Mr. Milchin.
Ms. Naidu Harris.
Ms. Naidu Harris.
Mr. Potts.
Mr. Potts.
Mr. Rinaldi.
Mr. Rinaldi.
Ms. Reneal.
Ms. Reneal.
Mr. Tebow.
Mr. Tebow.
All those opposed, please rise one at a time. Be recognized by the clerk.
Mr. Arnott.
Mr. Arnott.
Mr. Hardiman.
Mr. Hardiman.
Ms. McLeod.
Ms. McLeod.
Ms. Elliott.
Ms. Elliott.
Mr. Wilson.
Mr. Wilson.
Mr. Fidelli.
Mr. Fidelli.
Mr. Yakubuski.
Mr. Yakubuski.
Mr. Clark.
Mr. Clark.
Mr. Miller Perry Sound Muskoka.
Mr. Miller Perry Sound Muskoka.
Ms. Jones.
Ms. Jones.
Ms. Thompson.
Ms. Thompson.
Mr. Barrett.
Mr. Barrett.
Mrs. Monroe.
Mrs. Monroe.
Ms. Scott.
Ms. Scott.
Mr. Urich.
Mr. Urich.
Mr. Bailey.
Mr. Bailey.
Mr. Hillier.
Mr. Hillier.
Mr. Walker.
Mr. Walker.
Mr. Smith.
Mr. Smith.
Mr. Harris.
Mr. Harris.
Ms. Marteau.
Ms. Marteau.
Mr. McDonnell.
Mr. McDonnell.
Mr. Pettipies.
Mr. Pettipies.
Monsieur Bisson.
Monsieur Bisson.
Ms. Horvath.
Ms. Horvath.
Mr. Vantoff.
Mr. Vantoff.
Ms. DeNovo.
Ms. DeNovo.
Madame Gélinas.
Madame Gélinas.
Mr. Tabbins.
Mr. Tabbins.
Mr. Miller Hamilton East Stony Creek.
Mr. Miller Hamilton East Stony Creek.
Ms. Sattler.
Ms. Sattler.
Ms. Taylor.
Ms. Taylor.
Mr. Natashak.
Mr. Natashak.
Ms. Armstrong.
Ms. Armstrong.
Mr. Singh.
Mr. Singh.
Ms. Fife.
Ms. Fife.
Ms. Forrester.
Ms. Forrester.
Mr. Mantha.
Mr. Mantha.
Mr. Hatfield.
Mr. Hatfield.
Mr. Gates.
Mr. Gates.
Ms. Gretzky.
Ms. Gretzky.
Ms. French.
Ms. French.
The ayes being 58 and the nays being 42, I declare the motion carried. Ms. Sandels has moved concurrence in supply of the Ministry of Infrastructure.
Same vote.
All, same vote. Same vote.
The ayes are 58, the nays are 42.
The ayes being 58, the nays being 42, I declare the motion carried. Madame Milieu has moved concurrence in supply of the Ministry of Transportation. All those in favour? Same vote. Same vote.
The ayes are 58, the nays are 42.
The ayes being 58, the nays being 42, I declare the motion carried. Madame Milieu has moved concurrence in supply of the Ministry of Community and Social Services. All those in favour, please rise. Same vote. Agreed.
The ayes are 58, the nays are 42.
The ayes being 58 and the nays being 42, I declare the motion carried. Madame Milieu has moved concurrence in supply of the Ministry of Energy. All those in favour, please. Same vote. Same vote.
The ayes are 58, the nays are 42.
The ayes being 58 and the nays being 42, I declare the motion carried. By that, Mayor has moved concurrence to supply the Ministry of Finance. All those in favour, please rise. Same vote. Agreed. Same vote.
The ayes are 58, the nays are 42.
The ayes being 58 and the nays being 42, I declare the motion carried. Mr. Flynn has moved concurrence to supply the Ministry of Health and Long-Term Care. All those in favour, same vote. Agreed. Same vote.
The ayes are 58, the nays are 42.
The ayes being 58 and the nays being 42, I declare the motion carried. Mr. Flynn has moved concurrence to supply the Ministry of Aboriginal Affairs. All those in favour, same vote. Same vote. Agreed.
The ayes are 58, the nays are 42.
The ayes being 58 and the nays being 42, I declare the motion carried. Mr. Flynn has moved concurrence to supply the Office of Francophone Affairs. All those in favour, please rise. Same vote. Same vote. Agreed.
The ayes are 58, the nays are 42.
The ayes being 58, the nays being 42, I declare the motion carried. Mr. Flynn has moved concurrence to supply the Ministry of Consumer Services. Same vote. Same vote. Agreed.
The ayes are 58, the nays are 42.
The ayes being 58 and the nays being 42, I declare the motion carried. There are no further deferred votes. This House stands recessed until 3 p.m. this afternoon. Sorry. I was in the dismissal.